Velkommen til Oslo Freedom Forum. Welcome to the Oslo Freedom Forum. We know some of our dissidents are passionate rebels, but please follow these rules to help us run the conference smoothly. Please be seated and turn your phone on silent now. Be respectful of the speakers. They have worked very hard and have traveled long distances to be here. Please be present and be on time. Many of you have also traveled great distances to be here. Honor your own time. If you have a laptop or an iPad, please sit in the back of the theater so that you do not disturb those around you. Additionally, there is a lounge available just outside of the entrance to the main stage, where you can watch the program while working. If, for whatever reason, you have to leave the theater, please do not use the center aisle while leaving or returning to your seat. If you need any help, please ask a staff member. We are wearing white badges. Thank you, and enjoy the day's programming. Velkommen.
Happening all over the world is an issue that concerns every single citizen.
Many of the rights we take for granted in the democratic world are a daily struggle for over 4 billion people.
No freedom of speech, expression, religion, no rule of law, no free and fair elections, and certainly no separation of powers.
Protesters, activists, and journalists often face violence and brutality because of their struggle for freedom.
Corruption, tyranny, abuse of power do not go on a break.
We believe that the only way to rise against tyranny is through a united global movement. This is precisely what HRF is working to build. By supporting and bringing together activists from all around the world who are standing up to authoritarianism, exposing dictators and their corrupt regime, and creating innovative solutions to strengthen democracy, we will succeed.
The most important thing is to be part of a network that empowers you. And the Human Rights Foundation is such a network.
Our work has to go beyond simply sharing the message of these activists, dissidents, and journalists.
We have microgrant programs that support activists in crisis in places like Belarus. Tens of thousands of Belarusians were put into prison. So we started the Belarus Solidarity Fund.
Most of the programs that support activists take them out of their environments and their movements. What the Freedom Fellowship does is supply them with digital security, fundraising, media, nonviolent movement building in a way that doesn't disrupt their work, but actually adds to what they are doing.
HRF's impact litigation program is able to place the really necessary international legal pressure on these tyrants to facilitate the release and resettlement of political prisoners of conscience.
Putin's regime organized horrible repression campaign against activists in Russia. Thanks to Human Rights Foundation, we were able to organize evacuation for dozens of Russian grassroots activists to safe places.
I was arrested in Zimbabwe, and when the Human Rights Foundation stepped in, they put together a case that could be presented at the United Nations. The United Nations actually issued a statement to the Zimbabwean government to let me go and allow me to enjoy my freedom.
It means seeing someone go from solitary confinement 1 year to speaking on the main stage at the Oslo Freedom Forum the next.
A political prisoner's worst nightmare is to be forgotten. Public spotlight, this is the only thing that can work.
Only together we are stronger. There are many troublemakers like me, and I feel I am among my family.
Human rights activists and dissidents, they may often feel alone, and HRF is able to bring them together so that they see that the struggle is often a shared one.
It's this extraordinary universal knitting machine that knits us all together.
We celebrate powerful stories that spark actions.
You play an important role in our democracy movement.
We need to assume that the fight for freedom in each one of our countries is the fight for freedom in all of our countries. It's only when we choose to do this and put ourselves from empathy into compassion, we will actually be able to move the powers that be to do something similar.
Good morning and welcome. It's wonderful to be back in Oslo. The world has changed so much since we were last here 3 years ago. We faced a pandemic, new wars, an intensified assault on freedom and democracy. Each of these is a result of authoritarianism. At the Human Rights Foundation, our mission is to focus on exposing dictators' lies and supporting the brave activists who are pushing back with truth. Despite the grim reality that you see everywhere, from Ukraine to Yemen, the global movement for freedom remains defiant and strong. And over the next few days, you will each witness its scale and power. On this stage, you will hear from individuals who are taking great personal risks to fight back and build movement for freedom around the world, including in Russia, Kyrgyzstan, Tanzania, and Hong Kong. They are the defenders of truth, of peace, of justice. Some defenders are unable to be with us today, because they're imprisoned or banned from traveling. But you will nevertheless hear their stories from their wife, sister, daughter, or brother. They have become their voice. You will also interact with innovators and change makers who are putting their skills and talent to good, championing the causes of those who are on the front lines every day. The Oslo Freedom Forum can mean different things to different people. I've personally witnessed over the last 8 years how this forum is a lifeline for activists. Some have received so much support and exposure after being here that it became too risky for dictatorships to arrest them. Others have used this as an opportunity to start a new movement or partnerships. But for all of them, this is the place where they realize that they're not alone, because they meet a fellow activist, journalist, technologist, or entrepreneur who cares about the same thing. This is the place where dissidents are celebrated for their creativity and bravery. For me and my colleagues at the Human Rights Foundation, this is a powerful reminder of why we do this work and why it is important and urgent to engage in the struggle every single day. Everyone, each one of us here, have a role to play. And the Oslo Freedom Forum is the place where you can find the inspiration, the tools, and the network to become a champion of change. I would challenge you to open your minds over the next few days, whether or not you agree with everything the speakers say. And before you leave on Thursday, choose a cause, an organization, or a person to support with your time or resources. Look around you. If we all do this, it is no understatement to say that we can help change the world. Thank you for being here, and I hope you enjoy the next few days.
Good morning. I'm so excited to be here in Oslo. How are you doing today? Great. Yeah? You know, we've never done this huge concert hall, so it's the acoustics though are extraordinary. We can hear it so well. You know, the staff is really, really nervous. They want to make sure that you have the best event possible. They are backstage, they're all like super tense, and I'm like, could you guys relax? You know, this event is ultimately an event. This event is the opposite of what dictatorship stands for, which is love. And I was like, let's just have a really good time and make this happen. And the moment you remember that, then the tension disappears. And I wanted to just first frame the discussion and argument about what we're doing here and what this is for those of you who are new to this, for those of you who are watching us for the first time on the live stream. On the way into the theater, I bumped into someone who just kind of asked me, I don't know if this person has been to the forum before, why does the Oslo Freedom Forum not address the abuses and failings that occur in democracy? And I'm sure, of course, many people here have seen the horrific photographs of cages with children in them on the southern border of the United States. I'm sure people are very disturbed by those images. Certainly, the staff of the Human Rights Foundation, we're extremely disturbed by those images, very worried about that. At the same time, we're also concerned about the treatment of Catalan separatists, people who are involved in the Catalan independence movement in Spain, and people who've been put in prison for having those opinions. We're also very concerned with the confiscatory treatment that the Prime Minister of Canada, Justin Trudeau, has applied against those who want to protest his government, those who want to protest, you know, who protested the vaccines or whatever lockdown mandates existed. These things, of course, are very troubling to us, as they should be to everyone. But that's not our focus. You see, there are human rights violations, I wish human rights foundations, in every country in the world you will find human rights violations. But our focus here is dictatorship. Our focus is authoritarian governments. In places like Spain, or Canada, or Italy, or France, or Norway, there are mechanisms of redress. There are feedback loops. There's separation of powers. There are ways that a citizen can appeal to whether it's a court, or even take the case of the media. There are things like political parties. That does not exist in Russia or in Rwanda. In a country like Norway or the United States, the United Kingdom, a comedian can be successful at making fun of the government. They can even become millionaires. That's simply not possible in Singapore. That's not possible in Somalia. So because democracies have remedies, we want to focus on dictatorships. We're not asking for the world to only focus on dictatorship. What we would like is for at least let's focus as much attention on the world's authoritarian governments, whether they be competitive authoritarian states or fully fledged dictatorships. Let them focus at least as much as on them as we do on democracies. After all, as you've heard from my colleagues, more than half of humanity lives under the boot of authoritarianism. 4 billion people. We need to keep repeating that number over and over again. And so we have this unique platform so we can provide the activists from those countries an opportunity to find help, to find support, to know they're not alone, and to project their voices loud and clear. Dictatorships, after all, stand in the way of human progress. They stand in the way of medical and technological advances, which of course occur much faster in open societies and much more efficiently in open and free societies than they do in dictatorships. And you can see it exactly right now because it's happening in China, which is buckling under the coronavirus because their vaccines don't work. And rather than accepting help from the West, rather than admitting that their dictatorship vaccine does not work, look at what they're subjecting their own people to. Human dignity doesn't matter to them. Human dignity does not matter to dictators at all. So it's incumbent upon the free world to address that. And when we say the free world, we don't mean governments. We mean us, people. Let governments follow us, but let us lead the way. People think, oh, someone should do something about what's going on in such and such a place. That doesn't mean the military. That doesn't mean an occupation army. That means us, civil society. Let's us solve the problems. And why must we do this? Because if we don't end dictatorships, dictatorships will end us. And how do they end us? They end us with interfering in elections. They end us with financing extremist oppositions by infecting social media with so much of their content so as to make us think that we are essentially in a cultural civil war, when so much of it is being generated by dictatorship after dictatorship, of course, of which Russia is the best one at this, but so is China. You know, in the South, the Cubans, the Venezuelan governments, they engage in this conduct as well. And so you're understanding that they want to end us, because if they don't end us, they get that freedom is something that is contagious. There are so many theories about what's going on in Ukraine. Oh, it's because of NATO. Oh, it's because of oil and gas. Oh, it's territorial greed. It's political pride. You know, our sense is Putin knows that a country that is free, that contains millions of Russians living in it, Ukraine, is a direct threat to his dictatorship. Because if those people can live freely in Ukraine, then why can't Russians be free inside Russia? He cannot allow it. So we gather here to honor such people. And so many members of this community have sacrificed so dearly. And one person I want to mention and focus on for a moment is Vladimir Kara-Murza. As you know, Vladimir Kara-Murza, if you've been to the Oslo Freedom Forum before, has spoken here since his first speech here as someone who describes himself as a student of Nemtsov, of Boris Nemtsov, the Boris Nemtsov assassinated by Putin's government. Vladimir Kara-Murza came. Subsequently, he was poisoned on two separate occasions. He survived both poisonings. In both cases, they gave him a single-digit chance of survival. And now he's in prison for standing against the war. So I'd like to invite Evgenia, the wife of Vladimir Kara-Murza, to please give us an update and some remarks. Evgenia, can you please join me?
Thank you. Thank you, Thor. Thank you for your kind introduction.
Let me sit there.
It is an honor for me to be standing on this stage today, where my husband stood, my husband Vladimir Kara-Murza, stood for the first time in 2015, after his first poisoning by a team of assassins from the Russian Federal Security Service, whose only job is to physically eliminate the opponents of Putin's regime. Vladimir had barely recovered and was still using a cane. But after making his speech here at the Oslo Freedom Forum, he went back to Russia and continued his work. I share my life with an extraordinary man. That is not always easy. Not only because the Russian authorities insist on making our life entertaining, but also because Vladimir's a pretty big shoes to fill. Being a brilliant speaker, oh, he'd be thrilled to be here today, to be able to talk to you, to share his ideals, to make you see Russia through his eyes, the eyes of a true patriot who never makes the mistake of equating a country with its government. Unlike Vladimir, for whom the bigger audience, the better, I'm slightly intimidated by large crowds, but I'm standing before you today because, in the words of Yelena Bonner, the wife of Andrei Sakharov, and an amazing force to be reckoned with in her own right, and I quote, "Academician Sakharov considers publicity the main weapon in the struggle for human rights. In that sense, I'm a faithful and consistent student of my husband. End of quote. And I can completely relate. So I will continue Vladimir's work for as long as it takes. I will continue raising my voice against Putin's vile and bloody war in Ukraine. I will continue speaking out on behalf of all political prisoners and hostages of Putin's regime. And we will prevail. We will. Standing here today, I know that we will, because I'm not alone in this fight. There are thousands, tens of thousands, million voices like mine. And working together, we will prevail. There is simply no other option. And because I'm speaking on Vladimir's behalf today, I would like to finish by reading a letter from him, written from Moscow's 5th pretrial detention center. In August 1968, as Soviet tanks rolled into Czechoslovakia to crush the Prague Spring, the Kremlin put up enormous propaganda efforts to claim wide support for its action. All across the USSR, trade unions, workers' collectives, academic institutes passed resolutions of approval. Soviet newspapers reported that support for the invasion was unanimous. But then, one afternoon that August, seven courageous Russians, came to Red Square in Moscow in a silent demonstration of protest. They weren't there even 5 minutes. They were beaten, arrested, and herded away almost immediately. But after what they did, no one could say that there was unanimous approval in the Soviet Union for the invasion of Czechoslovakia. As the Prague newspaper Literarne Listy wrote that August, there are now at least seven reasons for which we will never be able to hate the Russian people. Today, as another dictatorship in the Kremlin is attacking another sovereign state, this time Ukraine, it also claims that all Russians support the invasion. But it is not true. And unlike in 1968, there are not seven but thousands of people who have gone to the streets to protest. Each one of them makes me proud of my country. It is now a criminal offense in Russia not only to speak out against the war, but even to call it one, up to 15 years in prison. I'm only one among dozens of people across Russia already charged under this law. The other day, a fellow prisoner asked if I wish I had stayed silent. Saying no was the easiest answer I've ever given. To stay silent means to be complicit. As my friend and mentor Boris Nemtsov always said, the cost of freedom is high. It certainly is. But the cost of silence and complicity would be unacceptable. So I have no doubts and no regrets. I only wish I could join you in person for this unique gathering that is the Oslo Freedom Forum. I know one day I will, and probably sooner than it now seems. As Soviet dissidents like to say, night is darkest before dawn. Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's the level of courage that her husband has revealed after all of these years, despite all of the trauma inflicted on him, is incredibly inspiring to so many people. And your involvement in this as well. You're both constantly in danger, and yet you continue. If only there were 10 more like your husband, I think things would be very, very different. And I'm hoping that this is going to inspire more people.
Thank you.
This is not part of the programming, but we thought it was very, very important considering his arrest happened very recently, and we stand with you on this.
Thank you, Thor. I appreciate that. Okay. And we will prevail. We will.
So, thank you. So, we've been coming to the Oslo since 2008, and just to underline to the activists who are here, to the people who are speakers, to our new speakers, this city has embraced us, has embraced our cause, hence what, you know, it's also called the Oslo Freedom Forum. We're branded and close together with the city. It doesn't matter who is in power in the city, if it's the Labour Party, if it's the Conservative Party. They have all been extraordinarily helpful, warm. They have given us not just financial support, they've given us ideas. And so it's my great honor to introduce the mayor of Oslo, who has a welcoming message for you, Marianne Burka.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, it's really an honor for me to welcome you all to Oslo and to Oslo Freedom Forum 2022. For the first time since 2019, we reconvene in Oslo again to discuss peace, democracy, and human rights. Over the past 3 years, we have witnessed increased authoritarianism around the world. Dictators have capitalized upon the COVID-19 pandemic to chip away at civil liberties, cracking down on protests and free press. And most appallingly, in recent months, dictators have shown the world that they will turn to war and bloodshed if they fear that their power is at risk. Developments like these have revealed the need for spaces like Oslo Freedom Forum, where individuals from all walks of life can unite in support of activists and civil society leaders who are preserving human rights under the most adverse conditions. The theme for Oslo Freedom Forum 2022, Champions of Change, celebrates both activists who are themselves champions and their causes. We also celebrate their bravery and courage, and the experience that the champions of change gives us all hope. Hope for change, hope for peace, and hope for the future. Beyond Oslo Freedom Forum's long-anticipated return to Oslo, I am confident that the program for the next 3 days will make this year's forum truly memorable. You have organized various special programming around the war in Ukraine, including talks by Ukrainian human rights defenders, interactive programming on Putin's corruption, and innovative artistic and technological projects in support of the Ukrainian people. You are also hosting our first film festival, which takes place in the evenings at Vika Kino and features documentaries about champions of change from around the world. You are exploring spot washing, which is becoming increasingly prevalent tactic used by authoritarian regimes. And you are highlighting how corporations have a responsibility to uphold the values for human rights when it comes to issues of forced labor, foreign investments, and even environment. So, dear friends, I take pride in the fact that so many events and conferences on the topic of peace, democracy, and human rights take place just here in Oslo. Oslo is a city of peace. We are honored to be the host of the Nobel Peace Prize every year, and that the award ceremony also takes place in the City Hall. We are actively supporting other initiatives related to peace, human rights, and democracy. Among the most important is Oslo Freedom Forum. We share a common vision of making the world a more peaceful, fair, and prosperous place. Freedom, human rights, and democracy are prerequisites for such development. When our shared values are under attack, it is immensely important that we stand strong and united in defense of our democracy, equal rights, and liberty. We must stand together and defend children's rights and human rights in a world where these values are under severe attack. Using dialogue as a principle and also as a tool, which you will experience the next days, are very important. Nelson Mandela, who got the Nobel Peace Prize in 1993, has inspired the whole world to see the importance of dialogue. With the historic Mandela quote, I quote him, "The best weapon is to sit down and talk," end of quote. So, on behalf of the City of Oslo, I welcome you once again to Oslo Freedom Forum 2022, and good luck with your conference and the dialogue. Thank you so much. I can remember the morning of 24th of February. It was still dark when I looked at my phone and saw a dozen missed calls. I dialed the last one, and that is how I found out that Russian troops had invaded the territory of Ukraine. We left our apartment, and my husband stopped for a moment and said that we had lived many happy years in that house. We had no idea if we would be able to come back home and see each other again. I said goodbye to my husband, grabbed my emergency bag, and drove into the other district of Kyiv, where my team and I were living and working together during the entire period when Russian troops were deployed near Kyiv. We brought up several hundreds of people all around the country to document war crimes. For 3 months, we registered the Russian troops, shelling residential buildings, schools, churches, hospitals, and critical infrastructure facilities. We are documenting the testimonies of the victims and relatives of torture, abduction, murder, sexual assault, and other offenses. Working together, we have collected more than 5,000 stories. There is no justification for Russians' actions. There is no purpose in doing this. There is no legitimate purpose to force people to go down into the basement, to order them to appoint 8 volunteers, and no purpose in shooting them. No purpose in using tanks to have fun firing at people on bicycles whose bodies lay scattered around the streets until liberation. No purpose in breaking someone's house, killing the owner, and raping a mother next to her 9-year-old child. No purpose in shooting a 14-year-old boy at close range who was just playing with a ball in the yard. No purpose in breaking into the house and abducting the math teacher, transferring her to Russia, locking her in a detention center, and shaving her head bald. There is no purpose in deporting 1 million people to Russia where they have no money or document and no way to get home. There is also no military necessity for it. Russians have only done the things because they could. Russia uses these crimes as the methods of warfare. They attempt to break the people's resistance and occupy the country by the means in what I call the immense pain of civilian people. And we are recording this pain so that sooner or later, all Russians who committed these crimes, as well as Putin and the rest of the senior political leadership and military high command, can be brought to justice. For decades, Russian military have been committed war crimes in Chechnya, Moldova, Georgia, Ukraine, and they have enjoyed impunity. They even got away with chemical weapons attacks against civilians, people in Syria. They believed that they can do whatever they wanted. We must break the circle of impunity. Europe must establish international tribunal and hold these criminals accountable. This war has a distinct value dimension. Putin is not afraid of NATO. Putin is afraid of the idea of freedom. He seeks to create a Russian world who claims to represent so-called traditional values, but in reality mixes dictatorship, corruption, and nostalgia for the imperialism of the Soviet Empire. Putin will fight for his influence in Europe, and if necessary, he will use a war as a tool to achieve his goals. If we are not be able to stop Putin in Ukraine, he will go further. 1 year ago, during the Revolution of Dignity, we fought against authoritarian rule and for democracy, for the right to live and develop our country where everybody's rights are protected, government is independent, judiciary is independent and accountable, and police do not beat students who are peacefully demonstrating. And we paid a rather high price for it. And now, in this war with Russia, we are fighting again to have a right for democracy. And our struggle is important for the entire region, where in some countries, freedom has been limited to a four wall of a prison cell. The success of Ukraine
will change the entire region and change the democratic future of Russia itself. That is why, when asking Russian human rights colleagues how we can help you, they reply, be successful. For this very reason, we require your help. Immediately after the invasion, international organizations evacuated their personnel, so it was common people who supported those in the combat zones, who took people out from the ruined cities, who suffered from artillery fires, who rescued people under the rubbles of residential buildings, who brought into the encirclement to deliver humanitarian aid. People abroad are not indifferent either. Someone is collecting donations. Someone is writing about what is happening. Someone is holding rallies, demanding their governments to supply Ukraine with heavy weapons. Someone has decided to pay more for gas by not buying from Russia because freedom is worth it. Be that someone. Call this war the war. Collect donations. Write about Ukraine. Hold rallies. Urge your government to supply Ukraine with heavy weapons. Stop doing business with Russia. Stop buying Russian oil. Take an active position. Do not just pose. Defeating Putin requires from all of us to step out of our comfort zone. And common people have a much greater impact than they even think. Mass mobilization of common people in different countries can change the world history quicker than the UN intervention. The work continues. And I cannot know the way my personal story will end. But I'm certain Ukraine will win and freedom will prevail. Thank you. Thanks.
The blindfold on my eyes smelled like nothing but blood. My hands were tied behind my back with heavy chains of metal. I was informed I was taken to execution. An officer was standing behind me. I couldn't see him, but I could imagine. He was talking to me and he said, "Load." When he said that phrase, everything changed. I heard all these guns behind me being loaded. I'm so close to death. Then he said, "Aim." A slight move in the guns, and it's one time, froze. My brain started to generate all these beautiful memories of the ones I love and the ones who love me. I really wished I had more time to imagine more people with their smiles. But there it came, poof! And I died. For the first time in my life, I died. I never died before. I don't know how it will feel to die. I don't know how afterlife would look like. Have you? Have you died before? Can you tell me how it feels to die? Have you? I didn't know. So for me, I thought, there, it ended, and I died. So let me take you back in time and tell you a heart-breaking, beautiful story. There was a person I loved the most in my life. He was my cousin, Bashir. We used to go and knock on the neighbor's doors and run away for fun. We had the first hamburger together, we built a greenhouse together, but also, we once tamed a bird to fly back and stand on our shoulders. And when the protests started in Syria asking for freedom and democracy against the corrupted Syrian regime, Bashir called me and said, "Hey, let's join them." We went to the street holding these flowers in our hands and saying, "Freedom, freedom, freedom," jumping for it with so much joy. But being peaceful with a flower did not prevent the intelligence services in Syria from protesting us, from imprisoning us. We were detained and we were put in pain in political prisons. Torture and starvation was our reality. But Bashir and I kept ourselves very strong by taking care of each other. However, the guard noticed our bond, how we cared. So the guard would come and force Bashir to torture me and force me to torture Bashir. Torture led to illness. Illness leads to weakness, and when you are weak, it's difficult to survive. We would be sitting in very small squares in tiny rooms like this, day and night. Crowded rooms, and Bashir would be in his square doing nothing but looking everyone in the eye and smiling. He always surprised me. We will be coming just back from the torture with the blood on our shoulders, from our head, and he would be sitting and smiling to everyone in this room. And whoever smiles back to him, Bashir would say a very optimistic phrase of his to them, saying, "Mi tuerde," which means 100 flowers. I would carry him every day to the bathroom, away off 30 meters, crowded with guards, angry guards that will beat you. And at that dark day, I remember he fell from my hand, so I would go to the ground and I noticed him looking me in the eye. And he was looking at me with this very tired face, but very smiling face. And he would say, "Omar, mi tuerde." And this phrase never meant anything to me, except at that moment, it felt different. It empowered me, so I actually managed to carry him and much strongly run with him until somebody started knocking me from behind, saying, "Omar, stop, stop." I can't stop. I would lose all energy I have, but I start to feel differently. Bashir was getting heavier, and he started falling from my arms, fell to the ground, and he was asleep. I would slap him on the face. Bashir, Bashir, wake up. I need your help to get you back to the room. Bashir, wake up. And he was so tired, he needed to sleep. Or more, he was so tired that he needed to die in my arms. And he did. I returned back to the room where I used to return back every day carrying someone in my arms. And the eyes very proud of me, but that day, I was disappointed in myself. I wasn't disappointed in Bashir, in the world of failing me for years, me and my cousin. And I came back, could not look anyone in the eye because I can't. Because the eyes are questioning me, where is Bashir? I could not look them, so I would look at the walls. The very dark, hopeless walls that are colored with our blood from the daily torture we had. And that brought me nothing but depression and one memory. Bashir used to sit in that small square, seeing these blood-colored walls, seeing all this depression, all this pain in these rooms, and he would smile and say, "Me tuerde," regardless of the reaction of the people. So I would sit there. Bashir's buddy is dead, but I can't live without him. He is the only thing I loved, the only thing I had left. So I would sit there crying, but would be at the same time trying to smile to the people all in the room. And nobody would smile back because it wasn't real. But I did it 2 days, 3 days, 4 days. And so somebody smiled back to me. And I remember that day I was crying and they smiled back to me and I could not wait to tell them that phrase, "Me tuerde." I could not wait to be Bashir. That was the most meaningful thing I ever done. So one person smiles and the other person smiles, and then we became 10, 20, 30. The entire room is smiling. We changed our mentality, the way we're thinking about our environment. People got some hope. Bashir, by doing the very small thing that he loved doing, very tiny, simple smile with a few words, he brought us so much hope and taught us, teaches you that to contribute, to help the people in the most need, you only need to do the things that you love doing. And these things could be very, very simple. Hope is great, but it is not enough. After sitting for hours, I was forced to stand to exchange place with the person who was standing. There was now enough place. So every 4 hours, I will switch. In my 4 hours, I used to be standing, waiting to sit because I'm in pain. But after learning from Bashir, I would stand in my square. Raising my arms, taking them down, forth, and back, down if I can, trying to exercise. Because I realized I can't be in prison just waiting to die. I have to try to survive. And if I die, let me die standing. Let me die trying to survive. And I wished other people would do it. And do it for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 days, and nobody would react. People sitting, and nobody would exercise. But then that guy stood in the room and start doing exactly what I was doing. And that person became 2, and the 2 became 10, and the 10 became the entire room. Bashir brought us more than hope. He brought us a way to actually take actions, to learn from what we have been doing for so long time. I'm so close to death. They shot, poof, and I died. I opened my eyes, I woke up, and there she is. In front of me after so many years was a tree. I haven't seen a tree in years. I would love to hug a tree after all these years. And I saw a bird flying again, and a flower, and grass, and color. I haven't seen color in years. It all was a mock execution arranged to smuggle me out of prison. I was so close to death. And if that taught me one thing, it taught me that my life has a value, it has a purpose. And the purpose of my life today is being a voice for the voiceless. Being here telling the stories of the ones who can't tell their stories. Being exactly what Bashir would have loved me to be. A champion of change. So for you, and for me, and for Bashir, meet Warde.
Save the war child baby who control the keys. The web we weave is thick and sordid. Fine by me. And while there is no Sadanai Nobabe Sadi Nane.
I'm going to be speaking very shortly. I'm extremely honored to be here today, and I feel very inspired, and in this moment in my life, I really needed this event to feel that sometimes there's light at the end of the tunnel. I dedicate the next song. It's a personal composition called Yuma. Yuma means mother in Arabic and Bedouin dialect. I wrote this song a few years ago following the death of someone very close to me. So I dedicate this song today for everyone here that have lost a loved one, for injustice, any kind of injustice, whether it's political, health-wise, depression. We are living in a world where it's very hard sometimes to create joy out of these kind of experiences, but in this song, I would like you to imagine a better place out of darkness. Here's Yuma.
Gallit rasama alla fogi fogi sha
The evidence gathered suggests that the killing of Mr. Khashoggi was overseen, planned, and endorsed by high-level officials, warranting further investigation of the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia and of his key advisor, Saud al-Qahtani.
It is such an honour to be back at the Oslo Freedom Forum, and a special honour to be here with you, Agnès Callamard.
Thank you.
Very pleased to be having this conversation. We are going to focus on Ukraine and on the world's response, and the fact that there is not one global response, and what that means. But Agnès, before we go in, I want us to start with context.
Mm-hmm.
What to you does it mean? How seismic, how systems-changing could it be that Russia decided to invade Ukraine again?
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for the honor to be here. Thank you to the organizers. The aggression against Ukraine, Russia's invasion of Ukraine, is more, although it's already something very important, is more than an aggression against a sovereign country. There is absolutely no doubt that Russia is seeking to unleash a new world order, or certainly to dismantle the current system. It is seeking to get rid of the rules, the few rules that remain that governed our system, and to put in place something based on power, and military power especially. He is also clearly intending to put a final blow to liberal values, something he already announced actually in the 2019 G20 meeting, where in a very well-known interview he said, liberal Western values are obsolete. The people do not want them anymore. I guess he took it upon himself to be the people. And that's what he's trying to do right now.
As we all know then, this didn't come out of nowhere. But what about the West, if we use that shorthand? Is there complicity there?
It's not a justification, but it is a contextualization. So what I'm going to say next is not seeking to justify what Russia is doing, but it is to put it into a context, and the context is 20 years of dismantlement of the international system, 20 years of dismantlement of the rule-based system, of the UN Charter, 20 years of little encroachment, which at the end become a big encroachment on dignity, human rights, and so on. That has been led by a number of states, but Western states have played a key role in that through the so-called war on terror, which has been characterized, among other things, by the US invasion of Iraq, which was, as well, a form of aggression. It has been characterized by targeted killings throughout the world. It has been characterized by the blurring of the relationship between war and peace, by a global approach to international armed conflict. And that is a context within which we are now seeing Russia's aggression. It is not an accident. It is not an incident. Yes, it is certainly linked to the regime of impunity that has characterized the action of Russia in the past, and it is a reflection of a system that has been governed to fail. It has been governed to fail.
I want to come back to the precedents this is setting, yeah, and what you have seen in Ukraine in the last few days. But To go further with our theme, the signs were there, the encouraging signs were there for Vladimir Putin. The lack of accountability for tyrants. This is the running theme of the Oslo Freedom Forum, isn't it? The lack of accountability for tyrants, whether it's Russia's Putin, Syria's Assad. And this has also been at the core of your work, Agnès. I'm thinking in particular of your investigation of the Saudi state murder of Jamal Khashoggi. The lack of accountability.
Absolutely. Jamal Khashoggi is a case in point. The person who ordered his killing, Mohammed bin Salman, has not been unaffected by the investigation and by the work done by human rights defenders and journalists around the world. But to this day, he's still not facing a court of justice, and he has not been held accountable for his murder or the detentions and the forced disappearance of many people. You're talking about Jamal Khashoggi. The other investigation I also conducted was into the attempted murder of Alexei Navalny, and that too is a clear. It's the way those leaders think and feel that they can act with total impunity. Imagine that the Russian government will dare to target Alexei Navalny in that fashion, as they have done with other dissidents, and do so with a sense of supreme power, in the same way that MBS dared to send a team of 15 killers to a sovereign country, Turkey, to kill another dissident. That is what struck me with those individuals, is they really have a sense of they cannot be touched. They have a supreme power over everything.
Okay, we saw that sense in Putin's decision to go into Ukraine, in the scale, the epic scale of the human rights abuses committed by Putin's regime, by the Russian army. You've just been in Ukraine, on the ground. We've already heard some searing testimony about what is happening within the country. But I'd like your thoughts on the scale and the systematic nature of it.
Absolutely. I cannot add much more to what Alexandra said in terms of the lived experience of the Ukrainian people. I just want to talk about Ludmila, because I spent quite a bit of time with her. And Ludmila is a woman probably of my age, and she was so shrunk by grief. She was so shrunk by pain and suffering, and yet she spoke. And she spoke about her son, her only son, his wife and their children being blown into pieces. They had found refuge in their basement of their apartment building, and that's actually what was targeted. And they all died. She got a few bones left from her son, and she was still looking for a few pieces of remains for his wife and the child. So the voice of Ludmila is what carried me forward during that mission, but there are thousands of others. What can be said about that you have not already read? But let me repeat it. At Amnesty International, we have documented war crimes after war crimes after war crimes in different areas of the country. There is repetition. There is pattern. These are not accident, something that can happen, maybe someone shooting by accident. That is not the case. We have a deliberate practice and policy of war crimes. So that's the first thing to be said. The second is the scale. When I was there 10 days ago, the authorities had collected 9,632 cases, allegations of possible war crimes. 9,600. This was 10 days ago. It did not include what's happening in Mariupol. It does not include what's happening in all the occupied territories. And as we know, they are discovering more war crimes, even in territories that have been liberated. This is coming on top of more than 30,000 incidents related to the war, such as destruction of buildings, people losing all of their properties. The scale is enormous. The number of victims is extremely vast.
The scale of this,
yeah,
and the brutality of it,
the brutality
seems the unanswerable to all, yeah, of us sitting here and watching what is being said here in Oslo. Russia's allies are few, and yet, look at the resolution at the UN. There are many countries who choose to be neutral, to stand back, to abstain, to be non-aligned.
Yeah, that's
what
that's
do
exactly
you say to those, yeah, who choose, at the least, not to take sides?
So one of the objectives for our mission to Ukraine 10 days ago was to tackle what you're talking about. The fact that, yes, maybe in Europe, we think everyone stands by Ukraine. That is not the case. In many countries around the world, governments, maybe not the people, but governments have taken a neutral, so-called neutral stand. I was in South Africa 3 weeks ago, and there they were talking about reinventing the non-aligned movement on the back of Ukraine. So there is a real push in many countries around the world for a neutrality on Ukraine. And so we went to Ukraine with, I had colleagues from Africa, I had colleagues from Asia, I had colleagues from Syria, colleagues from Belarus, and of course colleagues from Ukraine, because we wanted to show and demonstrate that neutrality is not an option. Yes, there is double standard by the Western world. There is no doubt about it. And we need to tackle that very forcefully. But the double standard of the Western world does not mean that we can remain neutral in front of the pain and the suffering and the killings and the wanton destruction of that sovereign country. The wanton destruction of the sovereign country. We cannot remain neutral. We must tackle double standard, but we cannot remain neutral.
What if, though? What if standing up seems or feels like standing up behind America, behind Western leadership? And what do you say to perhaps even activists in this room who might think, why should we engage when you didn't engage with our plight?
Yeah. We need to engage because of what I've said earlier. This is an historical moment. This is the beginning of the end or the beginning of the beginning. What kind of world do we want to live in? What kind of system do we want to create? When people take a stand, which is a neutral stand, they are not sitting at the table. When African countries are saying, oh, we're not going to stand for Ukraine because, you know, of Russia and Soviet Union helped us in the fight against colonialism. When they do that, they are not sitting at the table. They are letting, yet again, the United States and Europe run the show. And that will not be the way to go forward. We need to re-establish the basis for a global world system that takes everyone with them. What does it mean practically? In my opinion, it means first and foremost that the Ukrainian government must understand that the way forward is not just about Europe and the West. It must be about the rest of the world. The effort that they have put into reaching out to European Parliament, to Western Parliament, they must do the same. They must reach out to the African Union. They must reach out to the South African Parliament, to the Indian Parliament. They must broaden the coalition to support Ukraine. That's the first thing. The Western world could do the same. It's really very interesting to me that when the US started seeking to unleash support for Ukraine, where did they go after Europe? They went to Saudi Arabia. They went to Morocco. They went to the UAE. They went to Israel. They did not go to Africa. so far. They haven't gone to Latin America to try to bring stronger support around them. So that, to me, is, you know, is very problematic.
It's also about looking forward, isn't it? It's about saying this unthinkable action sets precedence. And we could spend a whole session, we could spend a whole day talking about China, but just in terms of precedence set, this is truly a global disaster.
It is a global disaster which demands a global answer. It demands a global justice approach. We are talking about setting the ground for a new vision for the way we want to live in. It means justice must be seen as being impartial. It must not only be seen, it must be impartial. It cannot just be the justice driven by a few governments and a few states. We need to build the basis for a global judicial response to Russia aggression. There is a talk of setting up an international tribunal to try Russian for the crime of aggression. It cannot just be established by a few Western states. That tribunal must be endorsed by the UN General Assembly. Yes, it may take a bit more time to get a global support for that response, but that will be a response that can carry forward the world, that can carry forward everyone, not just some of the few governments that are currently setting the agenda. Neutrality is not possible. It means that everyone must be at the table right now to build that judicial, that justice response to Russia's aggression.
And being at the table is an opportunity.
It is an opportunity.
In a time of horror, it is an opportunity. And I would like you to finish, Agnès, with a thought for those who are here with us, those who are already engaged, who are watching, who want to be effective. What is needed most as we look forward?
Reach out. Reach out to people around the world. Reach out to people who are not convinced that what Russia is doing is an attack on every one of us. It is an attack on Ukrainian people, but ultimately it is about dismantling a rule-based system, creating one based on power. And as my African colleague has said, it's a form of imperialism that cannot be accepted and tolerated. We need to stand up. Neutrality is not an option. We need to build a global response to Russia's aggression. We need to build a global justice to Russia's aggression. And we need to then look forward to creating the basis for a global system that will take all of us with them, that will treat everyone with dignity and equality.
Agnès Callamard, thank you.
Thank you.
Back in 2008, in other words, a million years ago, when people were still excited of sharing their BlackBerry pins with each other, what drew me to HRF as a young lawyer coming from a country ruled by an authoritarian regime was the promise that I could fight this and other authoritarian regimes around the world on behalf of innocent people that they bring to jail on trumped-up charges and secure decisions by international courts and semi-judicial bodies on their behalf, saying that they should be free and that their imprisonments are wrongful and illegal under international law. Thanks to the work of the Impact Litigation Program at HRF and dozens of lawyers over the years that have worked with us and helped us so much, we have been able to secure victories for hundreds of innocent people around the world and get dozens of regimes convicted internationally in that sense. However, many of the regimes that we fight against simply ignore the decisions by international bodies. because they don't abide by any law, and they get to treat the laws inside their countries as meaningless. So we get asked often, then what's the value of what you provide if the decisions that you get from international courts and semi-judicial bodies are not abided by, are not obeyed? And what we respond is that we really provide, beyond that, a sense of moral satisfaction to prisoners, to political prisoners around the world, who realize with those actions that they are not criminals. We tell them, by having this action, you're not criminals. You are heroes. You are pro-democracy heroes. You are champions of change. So we invite you today to come to our booth in the Art in Protest Lounge and join this movement of providing moral satisfaction to political prisoners by writing a postcard or a letter to a political prisoner from around the world.
So in my case, when I graduated in 2015 with my master's degree in international relations and diplomacy, with some student loan debt along with that, my dream was to work at a place where I get to do meaningful, impactful, and rewarding work. And that's exactly the type of work that we do on the policy team at the Human Rights Foundation. We give a platform and a voice to courageous activists that work day in and day out to promote and protect human rights globally. At the same time, we as a team of young intellectuals produce research and reports on the most pressing human rights issues, such as human trafficking, the impact of foreign investments on human rights, China's strategies of suppression, and framing justice in Syria. Over the next few days, I encourage you to step by our bookstore and cafe to find books written by activists, including former Oslo Freedom Forum speakers, as well as check out our reports written by the policy team at the Human Rights Foundation.
I'm also excited to share with you our recently launched Responsible Finance Program. And within this program, our first project called the Defund Dictators Tool. You'll see it in the booth. It is a website that will allow you to search through the $10 trillion ETF market. You're going to be able to see all ETFs in the world. You can search specifically highly ESG-rated ETFs and search what levels of exposure all of these funds have to countries ruled by authoritarian regimes. We want to make the finance market in general, we want to bridge finance and human rights, and we want to make, in this first project, the ETF market transparent so that investors around the world realize what percentage of their investments in these funds are actually going to indirectly many times prop up dictators in countries that do not respect rule of law. And so give investors this choice to choose democratic countries instead as an option for investments, and in that way provide the right incentives so that the global financial capital flows are going the right direction in supporting freedom and democracy.
Thank you, Javier. And thank you, everyone, for joining us at the Oslo Freedom Forum. Session 2 of talks will begin at noon. Have a wonderful day, everyone.
What does authority mean? countries, it takes companies like 20 years to become profitable.
Thank you. Va a estar difícil, si no la salía.
Welcome. Please return to your seats. The program is about to begin.
Imagine you are 20 years old and there's a revolution in your country, a successful one. A corrupt president who had been seen as a powerful force is not as powerful as many people thought. After weeks of protests, he is forced to leave the country and is not a threat to anyone anymore. This is what I experienced in my home country of Kyrgyzstan back in 2005, when we ousted our first president, Askar Akayev. That revolution made us very brave. You know, when you see that evil forces are not as scary as they try to look, anything seems possible to you. And those were the circumstances in which me and my friend Rinat decided to start our own media organization called KLOP. KLOP was very unusual from the very beginning. We started our own journalism school, and we would teach people, sometimes as young as 15 years old. They published their stories on our website, and more importantly, they wrote about politics, human rights, corruption, social problems, you know, really serious stories. But the first revolution did not bring the changes that we hoped for. The second president, Kurmanbek Bakiyev, repeated most of the mistakes of his predecessor. And by early 2010, his family members occupied some of the key positions in the government, in security services, in organized crime, and in business structures. That was also the period when we received our first threat. A person affiliated with security services of Kyrgyzstan, which formerly were known as KGB, by the way, met with me and Rinat and started telling us in all the details about another Kyrgyz journalist who had been murdered just 2 months earlier. And then this KGB person added that we might follow the same fate if we continue writing about the president and his family. We were terrified. But being raised by the spirit of the first revolution, we could not let ourselves give up. And at the same time, protests against Bakiyev were now growing and spreading all around Kyrgyzstan. And KLOP suddenly found itself in a totally new position. We became one of the few trustworthy sources of information for all the online users in Kyrgyzstan. Just in 3 years, we grew from a student project into one of the leading news outlets in our country. President Bakiyev was overthrown too. You know, we are quite good at overthrowing presidents in our country. Well, and it's, thank you. And you know, imagine how this was inspiring, especially considering that his tactics against the opposition and the free media were even more brutal than during the times of the first president. And KLOP has grown into one of the largest media organizations in Kyrgyzstan today. We have more than 60 employees. We publish news, investigations, videos, we observe elections, we make software. Thousands of people went through our various courses during the 15 years of our existence. And I can go on telling you about Kyrgyzstan and KLOP for hours, believe me. And however interesting it might be, you might secretly ask yourself in the end, so what? Why should I care, really? How important is Kyrgyzstan after all? You know, such a small, landlocked, poor country somewhere in Central Asia with almost zero influence on global politics, heavily dependent economically on its former colonial metropolis, Russia. But let me tell you a story. So in 2019, KLOP joined a group of media organizations who investigated the smuggling of goods from China to Central Asia, and Kyrgyzstan was a key part of the scheme. And we told a story about a Chinese family clan that transported goods through Kyrgyzstan without paying all the necessary taxes and tariffs. And to be able to do that, they bribed the Kyrgyzstan's customs service. And a significant portion of the bribe went to Raimbek Matreimov. Remember this name because I will mention him several times during my presentation. He was the deputy head of Kyrgyzstan's customs from 2015 till 2017. Our investigation revealed, first of all, the existence of the scheme itself, but also it showed how the top level of our government was poisoned with corruption. And what an important revelation it was. After we published the first part of the investigation, people in Kyrgyzstan protested. It was in the late 2019. And in 2020, even larger protests happened when Matveichuk's party was elected into the parliament. So as a result of these large protests, parliament election results were annulled, and Matveichuk's party didn't make it into the parliament. Still sounds like a local story, doesn't it? But no, it was not. And this is something that I want everybody to understand. There are no more local stories about organized crime and corruption in our globalized world. Yes, for people in Kyrgyzstan, of course, a story of a local government official who is corrupt was the most important one. But what about that Chinese family clan? We revealed that they had earned at least $800 million through their operations in Central Asia. And then they would spend this money all around the world. This is the property that they bought. You know, they bought houses in the US, in the UK, in Germany, in the United Arab Emirates. They had a number of companies in Turkey. So Kyrgyzstan is one of those countries where dirty money originates. But where does this money end up being stored or spent? If you live in a rich, prosperous country with a good banking system, very well might be that this money ends up in your place. Does anybody live in London here? Raise your hands, actually. Who lives in London? Some hands, I see. Not so many, actually. So if you live in London, there is a very high probability that within the radius of several kilometers from you, sorry for using kilometers, okay, within the radius of several miles from you, a shady business person from a country like mine bought a new apartment and brought all the worst possible corrupt practices to your kingdom. And you know, if these shady criminals would stick only to the criminal activity and do nothing else, maybe that's not even the worst case scenario. But what if organized crime becomes part of the government itself? Or what if the government starts behaving like the organized crime structure? You know, what if then they try to spread their influence abroad, maybe even to your country? What if they start wars? And don't underestimate the possibility of small, corrupt countries to be involved in the worst crimes. Look at Belarus. It is somewhat similar to Kyrgyzstan in terms of size and also in terms of lack of global attention, especially before 2020. It is also enormously corrupt, you know, with most of the resources in the hands of one person, Alexander Lukashenko. And today, the territory of Belarus is used by the Russian army to attack Ukraine and to commit war crimes. I needed to add part about Ukraine because I moved to Ukraine last year, so this is very personal. Could the whole world have stopped Lukashenko with harsher preemptive sanctions earlier? Maybe. At least we should have tried, I think. Let's come back to Kyrgyzstan. I mentioned Reinbek Matveimov, this former deputy head of Kyrgyzstan's customs. So what happened to him is, I think, one of the best examples of what should happen to a corrupt official. After those 2020 protests, we had the change of the government again. You know, we're very good at changing one bad government with another bad government. But anyway, so this new government, however controversial it is, had to do something against Matveimov. So he was arrested, and then he briefly spent some time in prison. But more importantly, he was sanctioned by the US, becoming the first Kyrgyz government official to be sanctioned under the Magnitsky Act. As a result, Matveimov is totally driven out of politics. He's a pariah even within Kyrgyzstan. His party does not even exist anymore. And all the current parties, they try their best, especially before the elections, to prove that they have no links with Matveimov at all, even if they secretly do have these links. So, you know, maybe we prevented another dictatorship from being born. Of course, we would never know. But what I know for sure is that Matveimov will definitely not be able to start any war in the coming future, maybe even during his whole lifetime. So what is my call for action today? Please support local journalism. We are very important. We have unique expertise. We start digging into stories about dirty money that then end up being spent all around the world. Please support journalism networks and collaborations. It would be much more difficult for us to publish our groundbreaking investigations if we did not cooperate with our amazing partners from organizations like OCCRP or Bellingcat or Radio Liberty, because together we managed to combine resources and also to protect each other. Finally, please do something about organized crime leaders and corrupt officials from all over the world who bring their wealth to your countries. If you're a journalist, investigate it. If you're a politician or an activist, demand better transparency and better due diligence. If you are from law enforcement, please arrest them, or at least their assets. You know, because networks of organized crime leaders and corrupt politicians are strong because they can efficiently cooperate across borders. But let us use this power too. Let us build even stronger networks of local journalists, politicians, activists, bankers, because by fighting local smugglers and thieves, today we prevent the world from the dictators and warmongers of tomorrow. Thank you.
Welcome to the Oslo Freedom Forum. My name is Bill Browder. I'm the head of the Magnitsky Global Justice Campaign. The Oslo Freedom Forum is often described as the Davos of human rights. And the reason I can't be here today is that I'm actually attending the Davos of non-human rights in Davos, Switzerland, to work with the big corporations of the world to encourage them to disassociate themselves with Russia and the Putin regime. My main mission in life is to get a piece of legislation called the Magnitsky Act passed, which freezes the assets and bans the visas of human rights violators, kleptocrats. It's named after my lawyer, Sergei Magnitsky, who was murdered in Russian police custody after uncovering a massive government corruption scheme. And in no small part because of the network that I've established, the Oslo Freedom Forum, the Magnitsky Act started in the United States and now exists in 34 countries around the world. One of the key allies that I've had in this fight for justice is Vladimir Kara-Murza. Vladimir has been with me in parliaments all over the world testifying for the need for Magnitsky Acts. For that, the Russian government has tried to kill him twice with poison, and he's barely survived both attempts. In spite of those risks and that threat, he returned to Russia, calling on the Russian people to stand up to Vladimir Putin. And in retaliation, the Putin regime has put him in jail, and he is now the poster child for this new law, which says if you call the war in Ukraine a war, you go to jail for 15 years. I hope you will all join me in publicly calling for Vladimir Kara-Murza's release and the release of other political prisoners.
We will not back down. We will continue our work, whatever the obstacles they put in our way. And I can speak to this from personal experience, because there's nothing better this regime would like us to do than to give up and run away, and we're not going to give them that pleasure.
Finally, I'd like to invite you all this afternoon to a session on corruption, rent-seeking, and the acquisition of loot, the central objectives of authoritarianism. A lot of good speakers will be talking about the tools that can be used to fight these dictatorships. Once again, thank you for coming, and thank you for being part of this event.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. In 2015, Magufuli was elected with the lowest majority in multi-party politics in Tanzania. He was an outsider from a constituency on the fringes of national politics. There, he used ruthless thuggishness to destroy his political opponents. He quickly rose through the ranks of national politics and became Minister for Works. As Minister for Works, he earned the nickname the Bulldozer for his efficiency in executing projects, but also cynically and for his evil destruction of people's houses in order to get his work done. When he became president, the first thing he did was to cancel the opening of Parliament and the celebrations for Independence Day. He used the sums he allegedly saved to buy hospital beds. And of course, this made him extremely popular. In reality, all Magufuli was doing was bulldozing our laws and the very institutions which were underpinning our democracy. He started to bulldoze our right to participatory democracy by cancelling live parliamentary broadcasts. He then proceeded to bulldoze our right to political freedoms by banning political meetings and demonstrations. He didn't stop there. He bulldozed the girls' right to public education by banning all pregnant schoolgirls from returning to school. He then went on to bulldoze our right to freedom of information by banning newspapers which were critical of him. There were some artists, such as the cartoonist Gado, who you see before you, who continued to do their work. By 2016, Tundu Lissu, an opposition member of parliament and a renowned lawyer, started poking at the bear. He called Magufuli the petty dictator. Magufuli's response was fast and extremely furious. Very quickly, sedition charges started to pile up against Tundu Lissu. He asked me to represent him, and I did so. And during a press conference, I reminded the people of Tanzania of the old Swahili adage, which says, a sculptor should never fear his work. And I told the people of Tanzania that Magufuli was our creation. We had sculpted him. We had made him president, and we ought not to fear him. Magufuli did not take kindly to my words. 3 months later, my office was bombed. 10 days after that, Tundu Lissu was shot 16 times. Fortunately, he has survived. We quickly entered an era of absolute darkness. There were state-sponsored kidnappings. Lawyers were being arrested. And bodies in gunny sacks started appearing on our shores, washed onto our shores from the Indian Ocean. As I saw Tundu Lissu's body lying grievously wounded, I realized it was a turning point for me, because it reminded me of the assassination of my grandfather in 1972. And I had a choice. The choice was, do I fight or do I flee? And I chose to fight. Not because I'm particularly courageous or I don't have fear. Trust me, I do have fear, and I don't believe I'm particularly courageous. But I really blame my mama and my baba for that, because I was brought up in a home which my father refers to as Mbweni Republic. It's in an area in Zanzibar called Mbweni. And there, the patriarchal system does not exist. It is a democratic home. Everybody has rights in that home, and we all have our say. So as a result, I really feel that I was brought up to fight rather than to flee. 6 months later, I ran for and became the second female president of the Tanganyika Law Society in its long history. I also formed the Center for Strategic Litigation with like-minded people. And we started taking on the regime in courts of law, nationally, internationally, and regional courts. I took on personally two cases against the regime. One was to challenge the independence of the Electoral Commission, and the other was to challenge the appointment of the Attorney General. I quickly learned that they didn't like me very much because they disbarred me permanently. So what did I do? I decided to use Twitter to continue my work. I used Twitter to educate the general public about the abuse of power that was what was going on under Magufuli. I also used Twitter with others to raise awareness of disappearances. And we saved lives. For us, Twitter Republic, that's what we called it, was a relatively free space if you were operating under a nom de plume. A few of us used our real names. In 2020, Magufuli engineered the conviction of 9 top opposition members for sedition. They were convicted and either to serve 6 months in prison or to pay a fine of $150,000. They didn't have $150,000 and they were promptly carted off to prison. And Magufuli engineered this in order to ensure that he had a smooth running without opposition in the next general elections, the 2020 general elections. What we did was to use Twitter to raise the money to free them. We managed to raise $150,000 within a period of 3 days, and people were contributing as little as 50 cents. For a moment, we thought we had saved our democracy. But you know, it doesn't work that way because Magufuli had the security forces and he used them to intimidate the general public. He ballot stuffed and he was extremely brutal. During the election period, there were disappearances and a lot of members of the opposition were imprisoned. Eventually, Magufuli redeemed himself and his ego because he became the largest winner in the history of multi-party democracy in Tanzania. He took the presidency by 84%. Magufuli's re-election campaign was run during the height of the COVID-19 pandemic. But the bulldozer does what the bulldozer will. He thought he could bulldoze the pandemic. And he did so first by ensuring that all victims were buried in the dead of night. He then proceeded to tell Tanzanians that there was no COVID and asked us to pray for 3 days, at the end of which he said there was no COVID. He discredited our national laboratory by saying he had sent samples from papayas and goats and the national laboratory had found them positive with COVID. Ironically, 4 months later, Magufuli died of COVID. Of course, the official cause of death was heart failure. 6 years of John Pombe Magufuli showed us the vulnerability of our institutions in Tanzania. I'm not suggesting that our institutions were strong to begin with, but the regression was unprecedented. Today, Tanzanians are no longer living in the same fear as they were under John Pombe Magufuli. We have a new president, Samia Suluhu Hassan, and there are some positive moves which are being made by her for reconciliation. However, we do fear her because she has a need to win the 2025 general election, and she also needs to appease the Magufuli supporters within her party and within government. She recently said to us that I allow freedom of speech because I want to hear what people have to say. This means that she thinks freedom of speech is her prerogative right to give to us, and it is not our inalienable right. We have a lot of work to do in Tanzania, and at the Center for Strategic Litigation, we are training young lawyers to conduct strategic litigation. So they took away one license, but we're going to make sure that we train a lot of lawyers to take up the work. Now, young people will fight dictatorial regimes either way. They can fight them in the street, or we can empower them to fight them in national courts, international courts, regional courts, and in municipal courts. So please, we would really appreciate any assistance that you can provide us in training our young lawyers. Thank you very much.
Even as the war in Ukraine grinds on, and thousands of Ukrainians lose their lives and millions more are displaced, amidst the horror and the heartbreak of Mariupol and Bucha, a new day for human rights nonetheless is dawning. For decades, authoritarians have proclaimed the weakness of democracy. The idea, the very idea that people could come together to speak freely, to organize, to determine their own future, was considered not only inefficient, but dangerous. And in their arrogance, Russian troops marched into Ukraine with parade uniforms. They expected only weak resistance from the Ukrainians and not a peep at all from the international community. But they were wrong, and today are facing fierce resistance in Ukraine from the citizens of one of the world's youngest democracies who are fighting for their freedom and for their way of life. And in the actions of those Ukrainians, the democratic world woke up and remembered the government by and for the few are the ones that are weak, and that democracies have reservoirs of resilience that autocrats can never fathom. The war in Ukraine has special significance for my team, Jigsaw. Amidst the protests of Euromaidan that ended up removing President Yanukovych from power, Jigsaw deployed Project Shield for the first time to protect an online news site called Ukrainian Pravda from the largest DDoS attack that had then been seen. And in so doing, we preserved the Ukrainian access to important information and enabled critical voices to be heard at a moment when they were most needed. Today in Ukraine, Project Shield is back in action, protecting more than 150 sites today, including those of NGOs, human rights defenders, publishers, on-site news, and also a few sites of the Ukrainian government. In the past 5 years, Project Shield, unfortunately, has had to defend 2,300 plus sites in 140 countries around the world from censorship. But supporting democracies requires much more than protecting individual websites, of course. And to counter the threat to global freedom that we are seeing today, last week in Poland, Jigsaw announced a new initiative called Protect Your Democracy. The goal of Protect Your Democracy is not only to protect essential public services through tools like Project Shield, it's also to develop new tools to protect other pillars of democracy, including access to the public square, advanced protection for personal identity, and to keep what's left of the free and open internet free and open. But we cannot and will not do this work alone. The activists who are here, the journalists who are here, the policymakers who are here, the researchers who are here, the thousands of everyday citizens on the front lines of human rights defense who are protecting their democracies. You are the ones for whom we build. You are the ones for whom we build. And we are all essential to continuing this fight. After years of being on the defensive, the Ukrainian people have created a crack, an opening for the rest of us. An opening for the rest of us. What was inconceivable just 6 months ago, is now not only not impossible, it's within our reach. Together, working together, we can turn the tide of authoritarianism. And I am proud, and the members of Jigsaw who are here with me are proud to be here at the Oslo Freedom Forum with you today. And we know that by coming together, we can turn this tide. And we look forward to doing so with you. Thank you very much.
Hello, everybody. Now I'm going to speak to you about creativity. Now, creativity may be your best resource when you are small and you are faced with a much bigger enemy. Now, it all starts with the most powerful nation in the world, your imagination. And we all have it right up in our heads. Take this random squiggle. It has no meaning or value in itself, unless we give it meaning and value using our imagination. Then we may see this. Or this. Or even this. It all depends on how we perceive it. Different people see different things. If you are a dog lover, you may see this. If you are a cat lover, you may see this. If you are a food lover, you may see this. The same thing goes for everything else in life. We give meaning and value to everything around us using our imagination. Your imagination can also be trained and controlled so you can increase your level of creativity. Here is a visual tool that you can try. A pair of eyes. If you put the eyes over here, this will be your point of view, and you may see this. If you put the eyes over here, this will be your point of view, and you may see this. So as you move the eyes around, new ideas will certainly come to you. Now, how about the idea of freedom? Freedom also means different things to different people. What does freedom mean to you? Is it to live in a beautiful house, in a beautiful landscape, and to be able to move around and enjoy life? Or Is it to be able to say what you want, write what you want, draw what you want, and be what you want? Or is it to have peace and justice and not be bothered for who you are? The squiggle is an open invitation for you to fill it in with the content that you want. Now, here's a bit about the creative process, if you like to try it out. If you give the squiggle a pair of eyes, it comes alive, and it's much easier to see what it could become. The eyes will lead you to the nose, which leads you to the mouth, and the rest sort of falls into place. Hey, this could be you, a warrior hero. All you need is that little seed that sparks everything off. Now, another powerful tool is context. So if we give it a background, let's say underwater, we can see ideas, surprising ideas, that we can never think of if it wasn't for the context. Now, how about the context of Oslo Freedom Forum? And this is where I'm going to need your help. Are you ready? Now, please tell me, thank you, please tell me, who is this? Anyone? Any ideas? Shout out, be brave.
Put him in jail.
Put him in jail? Exactly. Putin. Or how about trying something more uplifting? How about a hero? Anyone? I can't hear you, but you said something. Yay! Zelensky! And I hope you noticed that Putin's general over here turned into Zelensky's biceps. Or you can just draw yourself. A champion of change. Now, everybody, please come to my workshop Wednesday afternoon, and I will show you how to apply all this into your life.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. For the last 28 years, the same person rules Belarus. He managed to build a dictatorial system where no political opponent has chance to survive inside of the country. If you are in opposition, you end up either in the prison or in exile. Every day, he embraces new laws and regulations to make our life miserable inside of Belarus. We are put in the prison for leaving a comment in the social media. We are put in the prison for wearing white and red colors, our national colors of Belarus. Just to give you an example, last week he introduced a new, his puppet parliament introduced a new law. Under this law, everybody who is committing the act of the terrorist will be sentenced to death. You just can imagine. We live in the European countries. We are one of the European countries in the 21st century, and we are sentenced to death. Now, looking at three of us, you can see what Belarus terrorists look like. But the year 2020 changed everything. In May 2020, the presidential elections were announced in Belarus. Three strong candidates declared they were going to take part in these elections. The first one is Sergei Tsikhanouskaya, a husband of Sviatlana Tsikhanouskaya. The second one is Viktor Babaryka, and the third one is Tsepkalo, my husband. For me, a true leader is the one who has the following features. Number one, he or she has a vision for the future of his country. He or she needs to debate this vision in open and public discussion. And number three, she needs to be able to fulfill this vision in her or his country. Sergei Tsikhanouskaya became a very popular blogger in Belarus. Viktor Babaryka, he was a head of one of the largest Belarus bank, Belgazprom Bank. And my husband, Valery Tsepkalo, he built High Technologies Park, the largest IT cluster in Central and Eastern Europe. For me, they were true leaders back in 2020. I was next to my husband since the day one of the presidential campaign in Belarus. I got a chance to travel across the country. I got a chance to see regular people, to talk to the people. In the beginning of the campaign, nobody believed that changes will ever happen in the country like Belarus. But by the end of the campaign, people had a very strong desire and will that the changes will happen in the country of Belarus. Lukashenko, like any other coward dictators, he started to get rid of the strong leaders. First, he imprisoned Svetlana's husband, Sergei. Second, he imprisoned Viktor Babaryka. My husband, he was going to be the third one. But we decided we're not going to give up our campaign no matter what. So that's when my husband, Valery Tsepkalo, he made a call to Svetlana and Maria, and he proposed to unite all of us. We give up everything. We give up our ambitions. We give up our life for the future of the Republic of Belarus. And this is how a trio was composed. Many people ask me, what did Belarus revolution ignite? My answer is simple. We united people around two simple principles, not around a particular person. The principle number one, to release all political prisoners. And the principle number two, to announce new and fair elections. These two simple principles resonated in people's life. Very often, I'm asked if it was scary for me to take part, to be part of the presidential elections in an authoritarian country like Belarus. To be honest with you, yes, it was very scary. Because in the country like Belarus, you don't know if you will get back home in the evening. You don't know if you're going to hug your children in the evening. You don't know your future in a country like Belarus. But we made it. We made it. And one more example. For example, during one of our rallies, we were three of us, Maria, Svetlana, and myself. We were told that on the roof of one of the residential buildings across the stage where we were delivering the speech, there were snipers. It was one of the scary moments in my life. We didn't know what to do. So basically, we just turned around and waved to them. And you know, it was the moment of truth for me. I was next to my friends, Svetlana and Maria. We were shoulder to shoulder, hand to hand, and we were together with our people. This very moment, I realized we're going to win. Belarus is going to win. And then, presidential elections took place in Belarus August 9, 2020. You probably have heard of the level of repressions in our country. 40,000 people, innocent people, civilians, were illegally imprisoned in Belarus for nothing. Many civilians lost their lives. They were murdered. Not a single criminal charge was opened. Belarusians, they sacrificed everything for their future, for the future of our country, and for the future of Europe. Today, personally, if I talk about me and my family, because many people also ask, what about you? What did you sacrifice? We sacrificed everything, my family. All our assets are under arrest. My banking account, my salary account is under arrest. They even arrested our TV set and vacuum cleaner. It's funny, yeah. And you know, today, when we are not in Belarus, unfortunately, the leaders of opposition, we reside in different countries, in different cities, and we are not united as we used to be back in 2020. I'm a firm believer. Only being united, only being together, we are able to demolish the regime which was building for the last 26 years. Only together we are going to win this war. Живе Беларусь! Long live my beautiful Belarus.
On the morning of September 7th, 2020, my sister Maria Kolesnikova was seized in the city center. She was taken off, pushed into a car. She was threatened, intimidated, interrogated, blackmailed, forced to leave the country. Those 3 months before that, she repeated she would never leave. The last time she uncompromisingly confirmed her decision was just the last day before her arrest. They brought her to the border with Ukraine in a car, and she invented a very beautiful and resourceful way to stay in the country. She tore up her passport. And now we do not have Maria, and Maria does not have her passport. When she was arrested, I decided that I had to go there. I read the poem by lawyer Maxim Znak about Maria. I knew that poetry would not save anyone, but I decided to do anything I could to save her. I have been doing it for almost 2 years already, every day. From the very first days of election campaign in May 2020, Maria, my sister, supported her colleague, Viktor Babaryka, who ran for president in Belarus. He wanted to bring democracy to Belarus. When Viktor Babaryka was arrested, just a month after, together with his son, in June 2020, Maria became very popular. Everyone recognized her. And it was obvious that a legend has been born. When the trio met, together with Maria, Sviatlana, and Veronica, everyone noticed that they are very different. But it was good. Finally, the puzzle was put together. They work hard, they slept little, they forgot to eat. Their first performance and speeches, they were not professional, polished, or perfect. But it was sincere, courageous, and very inspiring. They went on rallies through the whole territory of Belarus just in several weeks. And whenever they go, people met them as stars, but not from distance and at a distance, but very personal and close. So I looked at my sister, and I was overwhelmed by her energy, but also the pride for her could not be without a fear for her. Then, when she was arrested, actually, repression started to escalate. Thousands of people went through prisons, tortures, beatings, dismissals, humiliation. Right now, there are 1,500 political prisoners in Belarus. And repressions didn't stop till now. It's 2 years of almost endless repressions in Belarus. My sister was sentenced to 11 years in penal colony. She spent already 20 months in prison. Though She doesn't lose her optimism, and she sends a letters that inspire people in Belarus and outside of Belarus. And I would like to share a piece of her letter with you. This is a difficult but extremely rewarding experience, especially considering my choice, or more correctly, the far-reaching consequences of my choice. I have repeatedly written to you that, having gone through this path myself, having seen myself and experiencing for myself how everything really does not work, I have no doubts about the correctness of my choice. If not us, then who? Or who, if not us? So I had time to think about everything about it. Would I dissuade Maria from supporting Viktor Babariko or Svetlana during presidential campaign? Would I join the campaign myself if I would know that everything ends like this? And all the time I have the same answer. Maria would walk this path, and I would walk it with her. First, because nothing has ended yet, because we exist, we are alive, we are proud of ourselves, we are very courage, and confidence in our truth is more stronger now. Second, because big changes often require sacrifice. None of our team members had a question whether to sacrifice or not. Just recently, a man who spent a year and a half in prison told me, "We had to do this path, and I have no regrets. And I know that my sister Maria, Viktor Babariko, his son Eduard, lawyer Maxim Znak, and many Belarusians who have suffered but who haven't been broken in prisons and suffering will say like that." Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sviatlana Tsikhanouskaya, and I didn't expect to be here. 2 years ago, I was a housewife, raising two hard of hearing children. I wasn't interested in politics, and even the fact that I can stay on such a stage was a nightmare for me. I became a politician by accident. My husband was a YouTube blogger. He went around the country and interviewed ordinary people about their life under dictatorship. It inspired him to run for president. And he was arrested immediately because he dared to challenge the dictator. I was very scared at that moment, but I made the decision to run for presidency instead of him. I was joined by two amazing women. Though none of us had any political experience, it took us just 7 minutes to unite all opposition forces. Thank you, Veronica, Masha, and Tatsiana for being with me now and back then. Your courage is amazing me, and I'm still looking up to you. You know, I remember my first rally. My voice was breaking. I really was afraid to forget my name. Since then, I have changed a lot. But my voice still breaks when I'm speaking in front of a huge crowd, though. Some things never change. You know, this is how our rally started. But this rally is still going on. We rallied against tyranny. Our fight brought hundreds of thousands of people to the streets for months. And despite terror and repressions, we haven't stopped our rallies for a day. We rallied for a vision of new Belarus. Belarus where the law protects the citizens, not the government. Where the police respect the people.
where technology defends democracy, where culture promotes our national identity. We rallied an international support for our cause. Our voice has been heard in the UN Security Council, in the European Parliament, and all over the world. And that's why I feel like I am under friends today. We rallied for freedom in Ukraine. Our country was used by the Kremlin to attack our neighboring Ukraine. We united into anti-war movement. Our fearless partisans sabotaged railways to stop Russian troops. Our activists fight alongside Ukrainians. You know, we already achieved a lot. As Veronica said, unity is a key, and we managed to preserve it. Now our civil society is rebuilding from ashes. Our media reopened from exile after being closed in our country. Our human rights defenders help our political prisoners. You know, it's very important for us. Tyranny doesn't happen in our country again. It's up to all of us, you know, to save our children from dictatorship. And I have to say that we already developed immunity against dictatorship. And it's our task to make sure that will not repeat in our future. And, you know, I have to say that you can make a difference too. So I invite you to join our rally for Free Belarus. I know that there are a lot of journalists in this room. So I ask you to keep Belarus on agenda, because our rally grows when you cover it. There are a lot of tech people here. Provide us tools to fight with censorship, from VPNs to blockchain. You know, our rally wouldn't be impossible without Telegram, for example, without civil media. I know that there are a lot of activists here as well. You have the power to turn deep concerns into real actions. We need strong advocates around the world. And I know that there are a lot of entrepreneurs here as well. Donate to our independent initiatives and organizations. Help us to launch rehabilitation programs for our political prisoners and for the children of political prisoners. You know, thousands of kids are waiting for their parents to return home. Thousands of families are separated against their will. You know, I still don't understand how to explain my children that their dad is imprisoned for 18 years. It's up to all of us to bring our rally to its final and win. Our kids deserve to live in a country without fear, without prisons, and without war. For them to have their own possibility to hold their own rally. But this will be rally not against tyranny. It will be rally for prosperous Belarus.
Final statements. I appeal personally to international community
to help us to organize and host the next Belarus Democratic Forum, which is going to be take place in Berlin, in Germany, in the middle of July. Thank you.
I would like to add and to remind that there are 1,500 political prisoners in Belarus. I know that Maria, my sister, loves to receive letters, as well as other political prisoners who need your support. Please visit the platform kletochku.org and write a letter to political prisoners. Maybe you will make, just with this simple step, you will make one day or several days of one man or woman in Belarus happier. Thank you.
And I ask you to start your own rally for Belarus in your city, in your university, in your company. Your rallies will give us energy to continue ours. You know, in 2020, during huge demonstrations, our people turned on the lights of their phones and waved to see how many of us are there. So let's recreate that moment. I ask you to turn on your lights and wave with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Живи Беларусь!
Живи Беларусь! Thank you for supporting Belarus.
I'm here to tell you the most unlikely story on how a crackdown on artists turned into the biggest peaceful protest movement in Cuba since 1959. On January 31st, I was with a group of mothers and activists in front of the 10 de Octubre District Court in Havana. At the end of the hearing, as prisoners came out of the court building, police and state security agents violently detained and arrested us while we were shouting, "Freedom, they are heroes." That night, while in prison, I was given an impossible choice: leave Cuba, or otherwise the government would charge the mothers of the prisoners with public disorder. In other words, they would make the mothers pay for my activism. Massive trials were being conducted in Cuba since November 2021 to punish everyone involved in the protest of July. 33 people were on trial that day. 6 were minors under the age of 18. They were charged for sedition, a crime against state security punishable under the Cuban law with up to 30 years or even death penalty. Roland Castillo was one of those young protesters charged with sedition. He was only 17 years old when he was arrested. Roland is a wrestling champion that won several medals in Havana's competition. His dream is to be an Olympic champion for Cuba and to take care of his mom. Yet, he became a different kind of champion, along with many others, like Brandon David Becerra Curbelo and Jonathan Torres Farrat. Their dream for a democratic change in Cuba remains unbreakable despite the harassment and the threat of state security. I know now that because of them, Cuba will never be the same again. Almost a year ago, July 11th marked a departure from 6 decades of totalitarianism in Cuba. Hundreds of thousands of Cuba took to the streets spontaneously. No one made a call, no group organized the demonstrations. In fact, when we went to sleep the night before, no one could have imagined something like that would happen next day. What began as a small group of protesting, broadcasting a live Facebook video with their phones as they were walking around San Antonio de los Baños town, spread like wildfire. City after city, hundreds of thousands peacefully took to the street. Within 2 hours, the Cuban dictator, Miguel Díaz-Canel, publicly ordered a violent crackdown on the protesters and called on his supporters to take part with total legal immunity for their violence. Obviously, the government was terrified of its own people. But July 11th was not an isolated event. Cuba has been in a turmoil of protests since the spring of 2018, when Miguel Díaz-Canel was designated by Raúl Castro to be Cuba's next dictator. His first decision was his first big mistake. He passed a decree law basically legalizing censorship. Its goal was to control artists and to control artistic creation in Cuba and curtail free speech. This is how the cycle of protest was born. But artists were not prepared to back into the already limited freedoms they have. So they left the studios and gallery spaces and publicly challenged the government with street performances. Some of these artists, along with residents of San Isidro neighborhood, gathered together in September 2019 and created the San Isidro movement, a grassroots reflection of the Cuban people. Today, 2 members of the group still remain in maximum security prisons, its leader, Luis Manuel Otero Alcántara, and Michael Castillo Perez, co-author of the song Patria y Vida, that became a national anthem for the protest movement. They prove courage is highly contagious. Movimiento San Isidro, relatable message of solidarity and defiance to the Cuban regime, drove many people to follow. A wind of freedom that Cubans haven't experienced in 63 years of dictatorship started swirling around the island. 2 years later, the indignation over the regime's action broke the fear barrier when on the 27th of November, 2020, almost 500 people gathered outside the Ministry of Culture demanding the end of repression against artists. A group of state security agents, the night before, they were disguised as doctors and broke in the headquarters of San Isidro Movement. They brutally attacked a group hunger strike organized to denounce the illegal arrest of one of the group's members. That gathering outside the Ministry of Culture was the largest anti-government demonstration in front of any institution of state since 1959. There were artists and intellectuals, but there were also engineers, architects, students, journalists, even housewives. As a result, a new group was founded, 27N. Its manifesto states, "Political freedom is indispensable for the exercise of any human right, insofar as they are interdependent. There can be neither prosperity nor freedom to create in any sphere of society without political freedom. We demand that all persons who have been tried and condemned for expressing ideas contrary to the current political system be released." From that moment on, the struggle for artistic freedom turned into an open demand for all civic and political rights. Cubans no longer tolerated being mere subjects, but wanted to be free citizens. Our realization that freedom is possible, that we all felt collectively that day, no repression can ever erase. The protest of July showed us that the myth of Fidel Castro's revolution has fallen, and that the Cuban regime is the weakest morally among its peers in Latin America. The real heroes who brought about this monumental change are the hundreds of Cubans imprisoned by the dictatorship. Their awe-inspiring display of people's power is a reminder that democracy is possible in Cuba. A stable, peaceful transition towards democracy in Cuba will have an immense effect in all of Latin America. In the global context of rising authoritarianism, we must stand together and resist. Let no one doubt on the immense transformative power of resistance. If tyrants are united, let them know that we, the democratic resistance all over the world, is united too.
I realize that I'm the only thing that stands between you and lunch, so I'll keep this really short and sweet. So the good news is that Cuba is not the only country where artists are taking the lead in the struggle for human rights. Far from it. In fact, from Afghanistan to Russia, from Burma to Sudan, artists are using the nonviolent power of art to respond to the violence of authoritarian power. At the Human Rights Foundation, we're doing our part. Did you know that we have dedicated a program to supporting dissident artists? Our program is called Art in Protest. The idea is to provide a safe space for dissident artists, as well as a platform to elevate their work. For example, last year, in collaboration with the Gray Area Foundation for the Arts, we launched our first residency for dissident artists. An artist residency is a tremendous opportunity for an artist to develop their skills in a safe space, as well as sell their work. In addition, we have also curated two digital collections of protest art that you can find in our virtual galleries. I encourage you to follow us on social media at Art in Protest. But art is also a huge part of the Oslo Freedom Forum. As you head to lunch, please visit the various exhibits of the Oslo Freedom Forum Expo, which are located throughout this building and downstairs, particularly the Art in Protest Lounge. From virtual reality to gaming, to writing letters to political prisoners, you will find something that piques your interest. As my colleague said earlier, if you're interested in books or literature, please check out the HRF bookstore, where you can find award-winning titles by current and former Oslo Freedom Forum speakers, as well as a collection of banned books that you cannot find anywhere. If you're interested in cinema, please check out the various film screenings in the evening. But we still have a full afternoon of interactive programming with workshops, fireside conversations. So we encourage you to immerse yourself even more in our community and in conversations off the stage. At this point, we would like to invite you to go to lunch and come back to the theater around 2:30 for a full afternoon of programming. And my colleague will give you more details about lunch.
Thank you. Just a note for lunch, if you have a purple all-access badge, the lunch is just right through the back doors in the, it's like the glass house, the top of the glass house. For those of you with the green badges, we have lunch available for purchase in the plaza or also down in the Art in Protest Lounge.
Excellent.
Thank you all so much.
All right, thank you.
South Sudan, my friend?
No, from Kenya.
Oh, okay.